Does anyone know what it means to be brave?
Yeah.
All right. James? Fearless. Okay, that's great. Anyone else know what it means to be brave? Yes. Well, when you're brave, you kind of have to really, yes, you're usually scared, but you do it anyway, right? Okay, I'm going to tell you a story this morning about a little girl named Ruth. And
this picture has my heart. What happened very first?
For me is that when I'm scared and I don't have enough courage, I look at this picture and it reminds me to be brave. When we get to movies, since you don't know her very well, there were a couple people in the Bible just to illustrate what it means to be brave. I think David, when he went up against Goliath, was he brave? Okay. What about Hebrew boys would have said, no matter what, we're not going to bow down to that statue. And what happened to them? They got thrown into the fiery furnace. They were brave. All right. This little girl named Ruby, it was a long time ago. 1960. Who was alive then? Like they are now. And at that time, little black children and little white children did not go to school together. The law said they had to go to different schools. But as time went on, something came called integration, where they could go to the same school. And Ruby Bridges was one of the first little girls to make this happen. And so she took a special test, and only six children scored high enough on that test. And she was one of the six children. So she could go to school to integrate the school, to let black children and white children be able to go to school together. But she just didn't get up and walk into the school and say, good morning, teacher, here I am. When she tried to go to school, people lined up all along the way, saying mean things to her, throwing tomatoes at her, just being really rude. And all she wanted to do was get a good education. And it was so difficult for her to go to school, they had to get special police to walk with her to school. She couldn't just hold her little friend's hand and play hopscotch and sing songs as they walked along. The special police had to protect her. And when she went to school, there were no other little boys or girls in her classroom. It was just Ruby and her teacher. Because the parents wouldn't allow their children to be in the same classroom with her. So for that entire year, it was Ruby and her teacher. But you know, God is so good. And as time went on, things got a little better and a little better. And eventually, little black boys and girls and little white boys and girls, they were able to be in the same classroom. They were able to learn together. They were able to study together. And the song we just sang, it said, it doesn't matter if you're red or yellow, black or white, Jesus loves us all. And what I want my little boys and girls to take away today, even if you're in kindergarten or pre-K or third grade or fourth grade, remember that somebody had to go through really hard times for you to be able to sit in your classroom and study as you do. So always remember, be brave, do the right thing, and God will always help you if you ask Him. Study hard, and remember, somebody had to pay the price for you to be where you are today. to God. All right. And who would like to pray for me today? Jesus, you have some prayer warriors. Who is this little young man? I don't know your name, but he said, all right, Seth is going to pray.
We're not biased, but you're from Jamaica, so. Bible. And to this union, God has blessed them with three grown sons, Ernest III, Richard, and Christopher. In 2010, Pastor Florence retired after 37 years in ministry. He and Sister Florence now reside in Point Siena, where he is still active in the church. And I say to God be the glory. We have to have you here with us, Pastor and Sister Florence. I'm glad to have you ministering to us today. You are, to some extent, blazing the trail. We have started celebrating Black History Month last year, if I'm not mistaken, and you are the first invitee to be here today. So you can put that on your resume. We pray that the Lord will use you as you present the word today. Our hearts are open to receive the word, and we know that the Holy Spirit will place them where He desires so that we will respond to the word of the Lord. So feel at home, feel welcome, and be used by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before Pastor Flowers bring to us the word, the illustrious, may it pour. At the place where the Holy Spirit can sow the seed of life before the word is presented. Pray for both as they minister to us today.
Have you ever wondered what it would be like on that great getting of morning? We call it the great getting of morning, but I wonder what you would feel like when the stars begin to fall. So with that in mind, I thought maybe you would say something to our congregation about our attitude to feel well prepared for the morning when the stars begin to fall.
Lord, water, water.
get in trouble. I'm gonna ask my wife to stand up one more time. This time, stand up for a while, because she is good looking every day. Come on, man, stand up. Not too fast, not too fast. Wait. I'm gonna get in trouble, that's all right. And she's killing that hat, boy. She loves hats, and I like feminine hats. As long as I'm limited in something, I'm fine. I'm having some little things, but me and the VA is working it out. But I'm glad to be here. Amen. I ask that you pray, and I ask that you will listen carefully why the Lord has put on my heart to say to you this morning or afternoon. And think about it in the light in which I'm giving it to us today, all right? I'm going to ask the millennials, they know who they are, to give the old man a break and not be on the cell phones and all that stuff right now. Just give me at least 25 minutes, 30 minutes, okay? Unless you call us about and say, listen to this crazy man talk, then I don't mind that. Just give me that. And I'm asking the older folks to just pray and you stay off your iPad and your telephone and all that stuff. And let's just have a wonderful time in the Lord this morning. I bring you greetings from my dear Pastor Edwards from the Pontiana Seventh Adventist Church in Pontiana. As you know, the Lord blessed us to do a wonderful edifice over there. Amen. We're thankful for it. We're still in a building program as far as the fellowship hall is concerned. And I'm seeing that you guys are still taking up your building from driving slow as you go. We're going to see which one God's going to bless to finish whatever we got to do first. Amen. Let's get busy. Gracious Father, not much, but make sure that nothing of flowers comes through. Take me, Lord, into your hands, empower me through your Spirit, and you in the Spirit and your Word enlighten us here today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Sister Horton, you've done a marvelous job here. I've been looking at the pictures and your leadership, and I'm just fascinated. Give her a hand. Yes, give her a hand. I know you and your committee work hard. You've done a marvelous job, and the pictures have been right there. I was taken back when I was a little bored at some of the things you've done today. We've come a long way, but the struggle continues. But we've come a mighty long way. Whether you're from the islands or the island of Long Island, we've come a long way. Amen. Your former pastor and I were very, very good friends, as you may know, Pastor Taylor. I was his mentor when he first came into the ministry. And he and my wife are from the same city, New Haven, Connecticut. That's where I met my wife. I lived in Bloomfield, right outside of Hartford, Connecticut, and she was down there in New Haven. And so the Lord said, let me put the two together. So we've been together for close to almost 50 years. Yeah. I'm a thorn in her flesh, but that's all right. The young man did a marvelous job reading our scriptures, so let's just get right into it this morning. Amen. I'm going to be talking to us for a few minutes, going from disgrace to dignity. Amen. And we're going to look at the man in the cemetery in Luke 8. All right? What I want you to know, the key text is verse 35. And it goes like this. You can turn to your Bibles and look at it. It goes like this. Then they went out to see what was done. Then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devil were departed sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed in his right mind, and they were afraid. Well, this is a little parallel between the black and white situation, but you'll hear when I get there, all right? Going from disgrace to grace. I think, church, that this has been the purpose of the black church in history, going from
just grace to grace. Are you with me?
Amen.
For the middle passage that is a slave trade was such a disgraceful chapter in human history that some people denied that it ever existed. And you know that people still deny that it existed. Even, well, I won't go there, but it's very current, somebody don't believe me. Some people rewrote history of slavery and said it was a benevolent enterprise. Others attached serious footnote to the pages of history and said that the black cargo from West Africa to North America, and let me also add the Caribbean, was after all a rescue mission. It rescued the black man from the jungles of cannibalistic Africa and put him on the road of civilization. That's what they say. How can an uncivilized act put another man on the road to civilization? So this is what some historians would have you to believe, church. That is disgraceful. Our mission, our purpose, our calling, our commitment, our charge today is to move from disgrace to dignity.
Yeah.
When the movement is a reality, it stirs a concern in our community. I'll pause there and come back. I said, when the movement, we are in a movement.
Amen.
This church is a movement.
Amen.
And we are a movement within a movement. Hello. When this movement takes place, when the movement is reality, it stirs a concern in our community, and people will go out to see what happened. You missed that. I should have got amen. I'll read it again. When the movement is a reality, you got that part?
Yeah.
It stirs a concern in our community, and people will go out to see what's happening.
Yeah.
What's happening? They went out to see what was done. Now pause at this section of the verse, which says they went out to see what was done. That is in the story. The people came to see what was done. They didn't go out to see. I'm sorry. They didn't go out to learn, just to see. The people that you read. They didn't go out to learn, but to see. Are you with me now? They didn't go out to learn just to see. They didn't go out to appreciate, but to see. They didn't go out to participate or become involved, but to see. And here is where the line is drawn between the role we play in life and history. Are we going out just to see? Some people become and remain eternal spectators. What did I say? Some people become and remain eternal spectators just to go out and see. You can see them standing on the sideline of every demonstration in history. They just want to see. That even comes to the church that way. I said they even come to the church that way. They can tell you when the organist or the pianist didn't strike the right key. They can tell you whose subject and verb, and Lord have mercy on me today. They can tell you whose subject and verbs didn't agree. They are not concerned about the reality of communication. You hear what I said? They're not concerned about the reality of communication. If another person says to you or to me, I is going to kill you, I think you will get the message. Even though the grammatical construction of this statement may not be according to the Anglo-Saxon standard, the reality and the power behind what is said might start some changes in your mind and your view. And the challenge is, where will I stand in life and for Jesus? Where will I stand under the conditions of existence? Where will I stand in church and in this movement we're talking about. Let's go to this man. Luke underscores, look at the condition of this man. Luke number chapter 8, verses 26 through 40. You got it? Luke underscores three conditions. How many did I say?
Three
conditions about the man he was speaking of. One, he was at the feet of Jesus. Amen. And indicate an indication that he has some poles and coordination, and he had reverence. Amen. Number two, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed. The first one was at the feet of Jesus, right? Now the second one is sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed. He was not naked, symbolically or otherwise. He had dignity. And three, clothed and in his right mind, he was together. He had wholeness. He had integrity. Then Luke opens a wide door on the condition of the community. I'm used to walking back and forth, but I can't do that. Lord, help these legs get it together, because I need to walk sometimes. Oh, I need to walk, Orlando. I need to walk. God's going to bless me, baby. I need to walk and talk to you, because some of you are not listening to me. You're sleeping out there. You're saying, I'm from the island. Well, I got some for you folks from the islands, too. I'm from an island, too. Long Island. And then Luke opens a wide door on the condition of the community where the man lived. And they were afraid. Follow me now. We're getting to some bread and butter here, too. Well, where are we getting? Now, isn't it something that this statement comes after the description of the man's conditions and experience? That he was sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed in his right mind, and they were afraid, is the indication of how the man was torn apart, come on, while he was naked without integrity, while he was not together, while he was without his clothes, when he didn't know Jesus, didn't know himself, and didn't know his brother, nobody was too concerned about him. The community accepted the fact that he was consigned to a perpetual irrelevance. But when they found him dressed up, when they found him dressed up, what did I say? When they found him hanging around Jesus, when they found him together, Orlando, they were afraid. I see a black and white parallel here. Come on now. As long as we were struggling in the cotton fields, the sugar cane fields, and other fields of Tennessee and Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, Trinidad, Grenada, Guyana, Jamaica, wherever we were, any islands. Whenever we were struggling in the cotton fields and the sugar cane fields and other fields, with cotton sacks and sacks across our shoulders and to our side, picking cotton. I see some of you have never picked cotton. I'm from Alabama. As I was saying, I'm from Alabama. I'm from Alabama. From a little boy, my grandmother used to take me out picking cotton before I started school. Had a little sack out there picking cotton. One thing I learned quickly about picking cotton, you got some worms that bite you. Let me go back to my message here. Picking cotton, having your fingers burning with stinging cotton worms that hides underneath the cotton leaves. As long as we were barefooted, actually and symbolically, laughing when we were not tickled, no, we were not laughing, we were grinning. Let me say something. If I were going to preach a little bit of black philosophy, or psychology, I will tell you the difference between a grin and a laughter. Laughter comes from something deep within. A When it comes out, it's joy. Grin is a defense. We were laughing. We were grinning. Defense. Hello? So, Pastor, if somebody comes to you and they're grinning, I would take a second look and see what that grinning is all about. All right? As I said, I'll tell you the difference between a laugh and a grin. A laugh comes from inside and is an expression of joyous fulfillment, but a grin comes from outside and is a sign of defense. As long as we were saying yasa, as long as we were saying yasa, when we really meant heck no, as long as we were in that bag tied up, America and the islands were satisfied. But one day, America looked up and saw us standing before the Supreme Court interpreting the Constitution better than those who wrote it. Without contradiction in our lives that Washington and Jefferson had in theirs. Are you listening to me? Okay. After the Revolutionary War here in America was over, George Washington, rather than trying to build a free nation, was in New York looking for his runaway slaves. Patrick Henry, one of the leaders of the Revolutionary War, said, "Give me liberty or give me death." But he had slaves when he made that statement. I have often wondered, church, what would have happened when Patrick Henry said, "Give me liberty or give me death," if one of his slaves had stood and said, "Me too." But one day, America saw us marching to the voting booth. Pause. If you can vote, brethren, please vote. Don't just say, "I'm not going to." Vote! Especially what's coming up. I'm not getting into politics or telling you what to do, but if you have a vote, vote. I had to talk to my youngest son the other day. I said, "Christopher, you're years old." He's in his 30s. Oh, Lord, have mercy. My baby's in his 30s? Anyway, I said, "Christopher, how many times have you voted since that time?" Now, see, Christopher, he's not a millennial. What's the group just before a millennial? What do they call those?
Whatever.
But he's in that group. And they might vote, they may not, all depends how they felt. So he told me, and I was a little surprised. I said, "Son, if God spared your life from now on, don't you ever not vote again." Hello. So now back to this message. But one day America saw us marching to the voting booth, sitting down at lunch counters, demonstrating and protesting, and all of America became afraid. And as the movement continued, Orlando, every community in the nation found it necessary to draw new appropriations for police equipment. You missed that. They started training men to shoot better, not to think better. And they found the man out of whom the devil was departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed in his right mind, and they were afraid. Yes! Still afraid. You don't believe that, huh? Clothed, praise God, he was clothed. When you meet Jesus, something happens. I said, when you meet Jesus, something happens. Are you sitting here because you did not meet Jesus? You're sitting here because you met Jesus. When you meet Jesus, something happens. You go from disgrace to dignity. You go from a nobody to somebody. We've always been somebody. The Bible from Genesis to Revelation says we are brothers. We're not somebody. Adam and Eve were my mom and daddy. They found the man out of whom the devil was departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed in his right mind. And they were afraid. What about this man? Yes, let's Let's look at this man. We gotta look at this man. Are you with me now? What about this man? Well, I'm gonna sit down if you don't mind. I'm all right. I'll be all right. Ah, thank you, Father. I have it. Okay, that's good. What about this man? Because I don't want to be concentrating on trying to pull up. Let me just sit down. And the world saw the scars on the outside, but not the tragedy on the inside. He was lost, inwardly and outwardly. When Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" he came up with a strange response. "My name is Legion, for we are many." For a few fleeting moments, I would like to think that in the mind of the man, it rushed through his mind, "That's my trouble. I don't know my name. I don't know who I am. There are so many of me that I don't know which me is a real me. My name is Legion. I am lost. They snatched me from the land of my birth, lo, where there was melody and harmony." Oh Lord, we still got melody and harmony. "But they snatched me from my land, of my birth, where there was melody and harmony." Hello? Don't be ashamed of your melody and your harmony. My sister got up here a few minutes ago, she was singing, she started doing her little holy dance. Some of you probably frowned about it. You would be glad I can't move around, but I'll be doing mine right now. I'm not trying to show up, but hey, I come from a place where there's melody and harmony, and the folks can move their feet, not from emotion, but from involvement in what they're doing, and the belief in what they're doing, and the satisfaction they get from it. Pray for me. They snatched me from the land of my birth, where there was melody and harmony. Didn't ask me my name, just gave me a name. I don't know who I am. When you are inwardly lost, logically, the logical question is, who am I? When you are outwardly lost, the logical question is, where am I? Are you with me? Yes. This man didn't know who he was. And he didn't know where he was. He was a stranger in a strange land, a poor pilgrim of sorrow. Does that sound like us? Way back, maybe even today, some of us don't have us red sunflower shut up. I don't know who I am. Some folks call me the N-word. While I was sitting there and I was thinking, I remember I said, I've come a long way. I was born in, I'm not ashamed to tell you, 1945. And on my last birthday, I just turned 73. But I was thinking about that. I remember I've come from the N-word to color, to Negro, African American, black. I'm black now. I'm black American. But some folks call me the N-word. But that's not my name. Some folks call me boy. Oh yeah, I came from that too, boy. But that's not my name. Some folks call me boy. And I have already lived 310 years. Some call me uncle. But they are not my nieces and nephew. Did you get what I just said? Boy, uncle, little boy, 10 years old, uncle, who's your uncle? You don't look like me. My children simply say, him. My wife just says, that man. I'm sure Sister Paul has said that word, that man. Pray for it, brother. Some folks call me neurotic, some call me psychotic, some call me crazy, some call me foolish, and some call me no doubt. I don't know who I am. But then, brethren, oh praise God, I'm a part of the universe. But then divinity moved through history and touched that historical movement. And wings of angels touched his soul, my soul. And somehow, spiritually and reality burst out of history and said, I have got a new name. Over in Zion, I am not what you called me. I've got a new name. Over in Zion, I grew up with that. It's mine. I declare to you this morning, this afternoon, the man was lost. Can't you see the parallel here? A man's dreams. You're more than sick unto death. You are a murderer. You take away my purpose and slaughter my dreams. I have nothing left. You murdered me. Bless their hearts. They meant well. I do not hold them against them, but in resolve it, I was motivated to do more than what they said. I actually, folks, I'll just come out and say it. My mother said I was never college material. That's because my siblings were smart, brainy folks. I was slow. She meant well. But I remember before she died, she asked me to forgive her. But I told my mother, God used that for you to motivate me. Because I became the first one in this family, in our whole family, to finish high school, to graduate from college, from seminary with a master's degree. I said I was motivated. Hello. One more personal thing, we'll move on and close out. I was in the seventh grade, haven't forgotten it, in Ayer, Massachusetts. I consider Massachusetts my home because I spent a lot of years there. My father was stationed in Fort Devens, Massachusetts, so I consider it my home. I was there in my formative years. I don't know, some of you may remember my age. You may remember when they first like giving out those tests, the aptitude tests to see how where you should be placed. You know, what grade and what place you should be placed. In the junior, in the elementary school that I was in the seventh grade, they had 7A, 7B, and 7C. And then, of course, they had counselors that would give you those tests and everything to see whether you were college material or whatever. They did well, but I was in 7C. Motivation. Haven't forgotten this man's name to this day. His name was Mr. Scruggs. And he looked just like me. He says, Ernie, I don't think you're a college material. You should do commercial courses. Oh. I was motivated, but I remember. See, when you're in the armed forces, well, God just did some marvelous things. I started out in the seventh grade there, 3 months at that school in Massachusetts. My father got sent overseas to Germany. Moved down to Hartford, Connecticut. I spent 3 months. Wait. When I got to Hartford, and I was in the school there, they said, well, what's your major? I said, college. I was taking college courses. 3 months in Massachusetts, 3 months in Hartford, Connecticut, and then went to Germany. Well, one thing about the Army, when you go to Germany, they automatically say that you're going to be taking college courses. One thing about Uncle Sam, for his goal of his independence, they will make sure that your children get a good education. You know what I'm talking about. Give you an example. When I went to Europe the first time, from 1955 to 1957, when I was in the sixth grade, when I came back to America, and school was still going, I did not do anything in the classroom except help the principal because I was a year and a half ahead of everybody else. But anyway, when you destroy a man's purpose and slaughter his dreams, you are more than sick unto death. You are a murderer. Guilty of genocide.
And yet, your peers will not charge you as such. Much of these things are still going on with us today. By many of us, sadly, today. Listen, can I talk to you for a minute? Can I hear some tolls here for a minute? Huh? I won't come, I'm always getting by the back, that's all right. This American West Indian thing, boy, it ain't like I laugh, but Black Americans didn't quite like the West Indians, and the West Indians didn't quite like Black Americans. Some West Indians thought we were dumb. Because you got emancipated before I did. So you got emancipated 200 years before I did. And then when you worked on the islands, you were the majority, you were not a minority. Hello? Somebody learned a lesson when you came up here in the land of the free and the home of the brave. That stuff don't go too well. But anyway, but God has blessed and is blessing. Amen? So if you still got some hang-ups, forget them. Sister Flowers stole an American from America. I didn't steal a Jamaican. She stole me. You believe that? I won't get in trouble. You know, go on, brother. Lord forgive me. She said the first time she saw me, she was in love. I'm dead now, but that's all right. I've said this many times before. The first time I saw her, the first time she saw me, I couldn't stand her. Do you remember way back, ladies, when you wore those owl-like glasses? You remember the way out? Do you remember that, those glasses? The young folks don't know, but you know, you wore glasses.
The frame was way out.
Oh, they were green and different colors. She had one of them, pair of those things on. But then she took them things off, boy. I saw them eyes. I broke up with my girlfriend. But anyway, let's go. When a person is sick, they need more than a prescription from the drugstore. They need healing. And healing denotes great change. And great change denotes end of something, the fulfillment of something, and the beginning of something. That's my definition of revolution. And I know you missed it. Because I didn't get no amen. Listen to what I'm saying. When a man or a person is sick, okay? They need more than prescriptions from the drugstore. They need healing. And healing denotes change. When you heal, you have change. You're changed. You got a headache, you take heat, boy, you're different, isn't it? Healing denotes a great change, and a great change denotes end of something, no more headache. The fulfillment of something, in the beginning of something. That's my definition of revolution.
Almost finished, folks. Think I'll be able to come back again?
You be quiet. This is my buddy, brother. I was his pastor one time when he had hair. I love him still. Not only was the man sick, but the world around him was sick also. Another way of putting it is he was an insane man living in an insane world. The record of his behavior and condition and position will give you enough self-evidence to call the man insane or crazy. Remember now, he was in the graveyard, shackled on the chain, right? But you know, you do the black parallel, that's us there, all right? The world would give enough empirical or self-evidence to call him insane or crazy without fear or contradiction. But the world around him was more insane than he was. He was an insane man living in an insane world. I know that the folks were insane because they didn't provide any housing for him. He needed a place to live, but he had to go to the cemetery. He needed a place to learn, but no schoolhouse was available. And it seemed as the folks broke down his altar, and he had no altar to bow. He needed love when they gave him chains. Wrapped him up with chains, tied him up and locked him up, and excommunicated him from the human race and criticized him for misbehaving. He was a crazy man in a crazy world. I want to tell you today, you are still living in a crazy world.
Did I say? Still living in a crazy world.
This must be a crazy world. A world that will send a little boy to jail for stealing hubcap from a car that was designed to go out of style in less than 12 months after it was made, and didn't give the man who made it the Better Business Bureau Award, must be a crazy world. Let me bring it home a little closer. A world that will send a child to jail, charged with juvenile delinquency for stealing a loaf of bread because he was hungry, and give the man a reward for stealing a bank, must be a crazy world. A world that will send a man to jail for throwing a brick and then crown a man with honor for stealing a country or a continent must be a crazy world. A world that will assassinate a Martin Luther King Jr. and then run a George Wallace, a racist, for president must be a crazy world. This was a crazy man in a crazy world passing through the valley of disgrace, a valley that all of us sometime or another must pass through. Our foreparents knew this, and they said, "You got to walk this lonesome valley. You got to walk it by yourself, or nobody else can walk it for you. You gotta walk it by yourself."
Amen?
Amen.
I think I threw out too many pieces of paper there, Brother Judd.
Nobody is exempt from the valley of disgrace. What did I say? Nobody is exempt from the valley of disgrace. William James, a brilliant American philosopher and psychologist, one of the leading thinkers of the 19th century, when he contemplated suicide. Henry Emerson Fosdick was a great preacher, but he came home one night with a brilliant academic career behind him, engaged to be married to a wonderful woman, and he said in his autobiography that he didn't know what would have happened to him that night as he nervously brought a razor to his throat when his father kept calling, "Harry! Harry!" When you're sick and you're insane, if somebody close by can keep calling you by your right name, you can find your way. When you need Jesus, you run into the light. When you miss Jesus, you walk like somebody that has liberty and grace because you're a child of the King. You are somebody special. So special that he died for you and for me. Praise God for Jesus. Oh, I love him. What a mighty God we serve. I can't understand why he wanted to stay with Jesus. You would have had the same desire, and so would I. Let me stay with you. You told me I had somebody. Let me stay with you. Something happened to him. What happened to the man? Some would say he had a reorientation of his personality. East Stanley Jones would say he had his master motive changed. Paul Tillich would say he was grasping an ultimate concern. The Word of God just says he was born again.
Are we born again? Yeah. Lord help me with this thing here. All right, I see confusion.
I don't know about you. I can't altogether adequately define what happened to the man. together to try to define what happened to the man. But I can borrow the words from folks that I grew up with, folks that you may know. I can borrow the words from them to describe a little bit what happened. They would say, I was on a downward road, no hat on my head, no shoes on my feet, no God on my side, no heaven in view, too mean to live and not fit to die. The handcuffs of hell on my hands, the shackles of damnation on my feet, but the Lord spake peace to my dying soul. Turn me around and cut loose my stammering tongue, sent me on me on my way, and ever since that day I've been sometimes rising and sometimes falling. But I made a vow to the Lord and I'm never turning back no more. I am going to run. I am going to run on and see what the end is going to be. What do you say? Last time, can I get someone to play something softly?
The children saw him walking and smiling to themselves and said, look, that's my daddy.
His wife looked out and saw him and said, that's my husband. And I can hear the man describing what happened to him. Can't you just hear him saying, I met a man named Jesus, and I had an exchange with him. I gave him my sorrow, he gave me his joy. I gave him my confusion, he gave me his peace. I gave him my despair, he gave me his hope. I gave him my hatred, he gave me his love. I gave him my torn life, he gave me his purpose. I met a man, Orlando, a man named Jesus. Now I can tell the world, I know I got freedom and religion. Yes, yes, I know I got freedom and religion. Yes, yes, and the world can't do me any harm. I have found meaning, I have found meaning, I have found purpose, I have found love, I have found trust, and I have found freedom. And that makes me a new creature. Amen. In Jesus. Amen. Amen.